riding on that new river train, riding on that new river train. Same old train that brought me here's gonna take me back again. Darling, you can't love one. Darling, you can't love one. Can't love one and have any fun. Oh, darling, you can't love one. Riding on that new river train. Riding on that new river train. Same old train that brought me here's gonna take me back again. Darling, you can't love two. Darling, you can't love two. Can't love two and still be true. Oh, darling, you can't love two. Riding on that new river train. Riding on that new river train. Same old train that brought me here's gonna take me back again.
Since the beginning of time, history's been recorded to help us not repeat our mistakes from the past, and historian David Sandiford has been doing the same here in Grayson County for the Freeze Cotton Mill to try to show us what went wrong and show us how it can be avoided in the new adventures of capital. As David Sandiford labors to record the history of Freeze, workers in the cotton mill for nearly 8 decades labored to make textiles and profit for their bosses. While David's work as a historian is not changing our understanding of human history as we know it, it is an important job to do to preserve the local history and tell the stories of those who have formed the communities where people live, and to tell the story of those who've built the industry of where they live. Just as the cotton mills went away, we are at risk for losing local history institutions like the Grayson County Historical Society, where David Sandiford spends his time dedicated to preserving the history of those workers and the factory that made Grayson County the county it is today. If we cannot go out and support our local history institutions, we will lose them, and that's why I think it's important for these historians to tell their story. And this is what David Sandiford will do. Tell the story of the Freeze Cotton Mill.
One of the important factors when studying the history of a county, especially if you're taking it to modern times with their industrial capabilities and the history of industry in the county, you start with Freeze. There was no outside industry until about 1901 when Colonel Freeze built the Washington Mills. A cotton mill building the entire town as he dammed up the river. However, that striving for industry began with the very first settlers. They saw mineral opportunities here as far as iron as well as others, and they were trying to utilize them. We have several forges even in the 1780s as they made iron. But a problem was, and continues to this day to some extent, is infrastructure, being able to do something with that product once it's out. Washington Mills changed that to some extent. Colonel Freeze was able to negotiate with the railroad, and the Norfolk Western extended the line all the way down to what was then called Bartlett Falls and built the town of Freeze. At the time, it housed about, or was capable of holding about 2,000 people. However, it almost never reached those numbers. In the western end of the county, the railroad was extended to service the growing timber industry. That allowed for the first time for people here in Freeze to be able to ship product out of the county, whether it be cattle, produce. A lot of them were shipping specialty items that they were making. And that began to really change the whole character of the county. Up until that point, we were a barter economy, very little money floating around. After that, we now had a capability. We had outside money coming in more than we'd ever seen before. And the changes, if you study that entire process through the 20th century, changed the whole character of the people. We became much less self-sufficient and much more dependent on the company for our welfare. The cotton mill pretty much stayed in line with what many people take from, let's say, the West Virginia mining communities in Pennsylvania. the town was built by Colonel Freeze or by the Washington Mills. Everything was taken care of by the mill. If you had a light bulb went out, they changed it. A porch needed to be fixed, they did that. They built the school, they built the churches. They owned the town, they ran the town. Now, after building the town, they had a company store, and we've all heard the old story, we heard the old song about the company store, you owe your soul to the company store. That wasn't true in Freeze. In fact, they were rather very cognizant of what you were buying and how much you were going into debt and wouldn't allow it to go too far. But to help that, and an interesting side note, I'll get to in a second, is the company used script. They paid you in script, and you could, of course, go to the company store and spend it. Freeze, at that time, was a dry town. You were not allowed to drink in the town. But just outside the town, there's an area called Sud's Holler, and it's called that just as the name would imply. You would get your company script on payday. You could walk up that hollow and go to one or two, if not more, what we today term speakeasy, and they took this script, which I find interesting because obviously it has to be, for them to make any use of it, it had to be turned in. So it seems that what was happening was you can't drink in town, that's the rule, but if you go outside of town, yeah, that's your business. The textile industry in the South really didn't take off until after 1860. Of course, we were growing cotton that was being shipped to the northern states, and that became a problem in the antebellum period leading up to the Civil War. But after that, as the South became more interested in trying to industrialize, we were getting newer equipment from up north because they were pretty much running at capacity. And it seemed to be, for at least for a period of time, very successful. It was great for the area. And I'll use Grayson County as an example. As it probably doubled the county revenues just in the taxes garnered, not to mention all the other benefits. Washington Mills built an electric plant on the dam, and they sold electricity to the whole area of the county. And the same was true for the woolen mill, Fields Mill, on the western end in Mouth of Wilson. And both electric plants are still in operation today. But beginning really, you had to say probably from the 30s, but especially after World War II, we were really beginning to see globalization starting to take place. We were much more interested in foreign trade, and sometimes not the best deals were made. But more and more of our industry, we were competing overseas and we simply could not compete with it. So from about 1950 on, you saw those woolen mills, all those textile mills slowly die off. And I could not tell you without some research how many are still around today, but it's very few.
After hearing so much about the history of Freeze, me and David decide to go to where the old mill stood.
Where we're standing right now is part of where the mill stood. It was a large footprint. The mill was 200,000 square feet over four floors. We'll see it as it goes down the hill. We're going to walk over here and take a look from the bank and overlook where the discharge was. After building the dam that was used as a primary power source for the mill, and a very large water discharge was placed. So let's take a look at what's left. As the 20th century was approaching here in Grayson County, there were changes in the winds that far too many people could not realize. As Washington Mills was starting to be constructed, and looking through the records of the time, mention after mention was made
local resources and personnel were being used. Suddenly people had more work than they knew what to do with. This brick is an example. This is what was made to construct the building, and they were made locally. The timber was cut locally. Everything they needed, for the most part, was local. Much of the equipment was from South Carolina and some from Massachusetts. Now, as people, the construction was being finalized and people were being trained to work here in the mill, in 1904 it actually began producing. Everyone living in town and some outside of town, rather than getting up and doing what they had done on the farm for so long, they were now coming to the factory when the bell rang. And the bell controlled all their movements when they took a break, when they had lunch, when they went home. The conditions that they found inside obviously were far different than what they were used to on the farm. You were basically doing the same job for 12 hours a day. At that time, there were no child labor laws, so you would have children here working as well. Officially, you were supposed to be over 12, and in some cases, literally, the child would put 12 in his shoe on a piece of paper. Therefore, when he said, "Yes, I'm over 12, he wasn't lying in his own mind. As these workers came into the factory for the first time in 1904, this has been one of the examples of the new machinery that we've seen. This was connected by a leather belt that would have ran throughout the factory, powered by the river. As the water was dammed up, it came through a sluiceway and ran into an underground mechanism that turned these large gears and these large wheels. During the course of operating, even a 12-hour day, and manufacturing cotton into cloth, the air would be filled with lint, although there were big fans that were placed. There was no air conditioning, of course. Not even later was air conditioning installed, because it affected the quality control on the cloth. However, certain regulations had been put in place that protected the workers. And never have I come across the workers I've interviewed so far that really complained about the conditions. It was what it was at the time.
How many cases of brown lung were reported from Washington Mills?
One might wonder how many cases of, for instance, brown lung that might have been reported. I have come across no records of any. Now, that's not saying that there weren't, but I have no documentary evidence of any.
While David Sandiford may not be the perfect historian, he does the perfect job of depicting the history of these local people who built this county. David Sandiford's work immortalizes the people who worked at the Freeze Cotton Mill. The work of local historians may not be as glamorous as blockbuster and pulp historians, but it tells history from below and tells the true story of the people who guide history. It's not politicians, it's not kings, it's us, the people. So I urge you to please go out and support your local history industry so they don't disappear like the cotton mills did in the 80s. Thank you.
Down by the New River, at the bottom of the hill, people came from all around to work at the Freeze Cotton Mill. The old cotton mill is gone, nothing left but pieces of stone. But Freeze Cotton Mill. There once was a time when cotton was king, as we worked at the cotton mill. But now the looms, they are still at the Freeze Cotton Mill. The old free cotton mill. Now your mill is tore down and gone, and many had to leave the home. But sometimes when the air is still, you hear the humming. But pieces of stone. But it